Hi, I'm Francesca, a self-taught engineer currently working at Netflix. I created this course because I believe software engineers need more than just technical skills to build a strong career. In this course, we'll cover delivering value fast, writing solid code, and an exercise to help you safely work with legacy systems. We'll also cover how to create more opportunities for your career growth and build authentic connections with an active listening exercise. Use the technical and soft skills you learn from this course to build a successful software engineering career. I spent a year and 9 months trying to get a job. And during that time period, I was doing everything that was recommended. I was working on my skills. I built portfolios. I went to the hackathons. I went to the networking events. I did my resume a bajillion times. And, everyone I was speaking with was like, I'm not sure why you don't get any calls back because it seems fine. But I literally got nothing, not even a rejection email for a year and 9 months. And if you ask me how I felt about it, I've never been someone who was depressed before in my life, but I think during that time period was the closest I felt depressed and despair. Because it's like that feeling where you try so hard, but you have no results from it, right? So yeah, I tear up just a little bit thinking about it because it was such a hard time. And so, yeah, and then just right as I was about to quit, I was just like, I'm a designer. Why am I trying to be an engineer? That was when that first interview request came in from 8th Light. And so this is my takeaway for a lot of engineers when they're starting off is that how hard it took for you to get your first job doesn't reflect the potential you have as an engineer, right? Because it's very hard and you just need that one opportunity. And sometimes it just takes time, right? And so I think the goal, especially for folks getting their first job, is trying to figure out how to give yourself enough of that time and maybe cushion your finances a little bit so you can wait that amount of time while you're still preparing for the opportunity. There's a bulk of it right there, right?
I was waiting for the word tough.
Yes, tough. Yeah. Despair is how I felt. Yes.
If I may ask, what helped you keep the confidence and the morale up during that time? And also, were you working on your skills at the same time while looking?
Yeah, I was coding every day, with Chingu and stuff. Right as I got that job, that's when I was like, goodbye, Chingu, thank you. How to keep morale up? I think part of it that helped me from getting too upset was because I had this project with Chingu where there were other people. I was really learning a lot, and I felt like I was a part of a team, right? We were a team and we were building towards something. And so having that to focus on helped me not feel so bad. Because I think when you don't have that and you're just applying every day and then getting that constant rejection, you don't feel the little wins. And it's easy to get very, very depressed and angry about your situation. So I think trying to find situations where you can work in groups towards a common goal and that's still benefiting your skills, I think that will help. Ask questions. I know this seems a little obvious, but I've noticed that engineers are sometimes afraid to ask questions in the beginning because they don't want to look like they don't know what's going on or what they're doing. I argue the opposite in that the first few months is the best time because people are expecting you to ask a ton of questions and they're going to give you a lot of leeway. The opposite is that if you don't ask questions, you still don't know what's going on. A few months later, when you start asking those types of questions, then it starts to look not great. The other really big tip that I have is to request pair programming or shadowing another engineer that has at least been there for maybe a year to pick up all of the unwritten cultural and coding norms that's for that company. This is usually something that managers don't offer you, but if you request it, it's not a problem at all. And what it would look like is that you're going to ask to follow along with that other engineer as they work on their task for maybe a day or two, or even up to a week. And then you're going to observe what they're doing and ask a ton of questions, including, what are the good and bad parts in the code base? This seems like such a silly question, but when you're entering code bases, most of the time, they're like layers and layers of like code throughout time with many different patterns. And so if you were trying to figure it out by yourself by reading the code, you're probably going to get very, very confused, and you're going to waste time trying to figure out what is the most current set of code patterns. You'll also want to watch how they handle testing. So are they writing unit tests? Are they doing manual like QA? What exactly are they doing to ensure like maintainability? What's the PR process like? So after you create a pull request, how many reviewers are they adding? What kind of feedback are they expecting to receive? And then how long generally are they waiting? And is it okay for them to just merge without an official approval? Other things are, what's the pipeline to deployment? So once your code is ready to merge, how many stages is it going through before it's actually live in front of, I assume, users? Does the engineer have to do anything to shepherd it forward? Which documentation sources are reliable? A lot of documentation out there in the companies, they're not usually kept up to date. And so it's easy for you to go down the wrong rabbit hole, trying to figure out if what you're reading is accurate or not. Having someone point that out to you will help you move a lot faster. Ideally, they're also going to start introducing you to who your partner teams are, who your customer teams are, what do each of them do, who are the different points of contact in each of those teams, and when to go to them. And hopefully, if you have developed enough of a rapport with this engineer, they're also going to share some company-specific gotchas that you should know about. So all of this, you know, like, if you do it through this shadowing or pair programming experience, you can ramp up much more quickly as an engineer, because all of these pieces are actually really important for you to start delivering your work. We have all of our tests. We're not going to touch the new item first yet, because we need to refactor the code. So I'm going to close this window. I'm going to move this one over to the right, just so that I'm always going to be referencing this test suite as we go. So now let's actually look at the source code. So we have a item class. There is a shop class in which there is a constructor. These were the items we have been giving it. And then there is a single method called update quality, right? So inside of this method, I see that there is a single for loop that's iterating through all the items, making some sort of changes, and then it returns all the items. And that's what we've been seeing, right? Inside of this, based off of the name of the item, it is making changes to the quality and the sell-in value. So looking at this mess, I don't think I want to be implementing my new code into the structure of what this is. It's just going to be too complicated. And so I'm actually going to refactor this code now to prepare it for the new feature. Some notes here, everybody's resulting refactoring is going to look different because everyone has a different style. We're always going to be referencing the test suite every time we make a change to see what broke and what didn't. And the technique that I'm going to use here is to use a seam. So this is a very fancy way of just trying to say, we want to safely inject our new code without breaking a bunch of other stuff at the same time. And so what that seam would look like in this case is, let's see. So I see all of these conditions. I am going to write a new condition here. And I'm going to say, like, here, this.items, bracket I, dot name. I'm going to handle a specialty item first, just to make it easier for myself. I'm going to call it HBRI. And so all of my new code is going to be in this block. And I'm going to create an else and put all of the existing code inside of it. So what this does is that I now expect, if I click save, HBRI, so actually I'm just going to click save for you. So what I'm seeing now is that HBRI is failing, but all of the other behaviors are still working. So this is what I mean by like creating a seam where we're going to just figure out a place to safely put our code, but let everything fall back to the existing system. So we're not going to touch that, right? So in this case, we have HBRI, that code that we need to make pass. So when I refactor, I try to do it in iterations. I try to have a specific thing that I'm focusing on first. I'm not going to think about like the most perfect code and then like try to create that from the very beginning. So we'll do this in iterations. The very first one that I'm thinking about is when I look at all of this code, I can see that relevant pieces of code for particular items are everywhere, right? Like you can see something related to backstage passes in three places. And so the goal for this one is that I'm going to just consolidate all of the code relevant for every item. And I really don't even need to reference the existing code. I'm going to just write my new code that like makes these tests pass. So the very first test that I'm looking at here is that it needs to decrement the cell in value. So let's do that. I'm going to write this.items bracket I dot cell in. I'm going to decrement it by one inside. So we still have a failing test, but the assertion line has moved, right? The cell in is now passing, but we need to make the quality also pass. So this is also supposed to, it's supposed to increment. So this.items bracket I quality, I'm going to just decrement it by one. Okay, so that first HBRI test is passing, but the one about never being more than 50 is failing. So I'm just going to write that this.items bracket I, if the quality is less than 50, I increment. Otherwise, I do nothing, and in all cases, I decrement the cell in. So we have HBRI now.